Yeah, I think that Cape Breton in the Maritimes in Atlantic culture is about relationships, and sometimes it can just be about the weather and cutting wood, but I think having conversations that matter and relationships that you can draw together has just been one of the gifts of this time. I think we're taking a greater look inwardly at who we are and what we need to do to bring ourselves together. And I think when we talk about the earlier starting strong, and we're talking about what it might feel like for a newcomer to come to the community, or someone who's kind of been released from the big extended family is really living in isolation now. This idea of creating welcoming spaces was an attraction for everyone. Immigrants, first-time mothers, elders in our community. So it really started to create a poetry around this idea that maybe we're all desiring the same thing, but certainly the citizens from the beginning of life who really don't have a voice other than to cry are really asking us to create that space that I see in the faces of the elders, my own face. If I see the faces in diversity of the Mi'kmaq or a Gaelic speaker, I hear and see myself. So that kind of idea that the brain is ready to bond and attach in ways we don't understand, but by creating that space, we might be able to create that belonging and sense of connectivity that goes a little bit deeper than just getting ready for school.
We need to get municipalities involved in this. And so we started planning with Sarah Thompson of New Leaf to get municipal leaders together, just to start talking about childhood poverty. In January 2017, we held our first day of planning. And out of that, we came up with the name Raising the Villages. From that day and the 24th, in the municipal leaders, we decided we needed to get the whole community involved. So we had another day in February 24th, 2017. And we opened it up to all of the communities across Western Cape Breton, from Port Hawkesbury to Bay St. Lawrence. We had about 70 people come to that. And the big outcome of that was we need to do some research. We need to talk to people in our communities. We need to know what's working for our families, what do our families need more of so that we can really thrive. And then through the summer, we spent the time gathering data. We did, we developed a survey, we developed pop-ups at community events. We got service providers from the region together to talk about what's working well for our families here and what do we need.
We're talking about raising the villages. A good friend of mine, guy I've worked with many years, Jim Mustard, approached me one day about this idea about bringing together collective thinking around raising the villages, and really had a really good chat, sat down and talked about like where this could go, the potential of growing the idea and turning it into a project initiative. And of course right away it makes sense to me, because growing up in a First Nation Mi'kmaq community, we lived it every day. You know, it was a concept that our people have had for many years, that we were born with, we lived with. It was something that was part of our daily lifestyle. We understood it.
I like this project because it involves children. In my community, we have some, it's only aged population here. So I decide we need something for our children, for the future of our community. And seeing around here, we don't have that. I come from a culture that is all together, nurtured together. When I have my kids, I didn't have the support. It's no support. The culture, it means a lot for everybody. And for me, it was one of the more important part I miss. And I don't want the newcomers come here and don't have that.
To get this project off the ground, we needed to lay that foundation, and we've had to get these small grants to keep us going, to get our communications in line, to host a gathering, to bring people together, to print off our materials that we need. All of these small grants, the Rural Communities Foundation grant, was a piece of the puzzle that we needed. Without it, who knows what we couldn't have had.
Without a doubt, I can say yes, because it's helpful already. It's helpful in the work that we're doing. And, you know, who knows how many other great ideas are out there that that little project initiative can make a difference in people's lives. And the more of those we can have, I mean, when you look at Raising the Village initiatives, that could be one piece of that Raising the Village whole project. And then you bring all these pieces together. You know, a lot of those pebbles can certainly, you know, work towards many, many goals. So the work that you do and the work, you know, the small organizations do to fund projects is very important.
The Rural Communities Foundation funding was hugely influential. It does a couple of things. One, it gives us actual funds to do some of the work extending out that process piece that is really integral if you're going to get into actions. But secondarily, it created a confidence from the local funding base. So municipalities put in $1 per citizen. Where'd that come from? We were looking at matching. We were looking at trying to create a dedicated, you know, pool of funds that was almost open-ended. It had direction, but it didn't have precision. That's important in this time, because while we set out on direction, we're not knowing exactly where that's going to land. So that funding, even though we had to, you know, offer a flight plan for it, helped us match local funds, created a base of relatively open-ended funding that was process-based, and I think now we're at the action stage, so it was hugely important.
I think there's a great opportunity for this to happen around our communities here in Cape Breton, but across Nova Scotia, across Canada, and other countries.